Hi, I am Dr. Shakir Mansoor, and today I will discuss with you the methods to study skull. And in that methods, I will focus on two normas, Norma Verticalis and Norma Occipitalis. So this is a model of the, for your interest, to evoke the interest, to keep it alive. This is the newer trend. The previously I shared with you in my lecture on the skull, overall view, the study of the skull bones, the 3D video, a small 3D video of my system, and this is for my system exploded skull. You know that these days these models are quite common, very interesting to see. Look at that exploded skull. The model is exploded and all the various portions of the bones like this, the frontal and the parietal and the temporal and sphenoidal and this maxilla, mandible are all separate, and this is called as exploded skull. So in methods to study skull, there's first of all external aspects studies and all views called normal of the skull. Normal means specific sort of outline from which the skull is studied, which is the normal I'm going to mention you very soon. And the internal aspects is interior of the vault and interior of the base, cranial fossae, the interior cranial fossa, the middle cranial fossa, and the posterior cranial fossa. So exterior of the skull study, yes, it's total, it is done in the five normas. As I told you, this norma is an outline of the skull from a side, or which is possible, whatsoever the possible sides are. From the above is the Norma Verticalis. From the behind is the Norma Occipitalis. From the front is the Norma Frontalis. From the lateral side is the Norma Lateralis. And from the inferior side is the Norma Basalis. Right? So Norma Verticalis, Norma Occipitalis, Norma Frontalis, Norma Lateralis, and Basalis. So let's study in detail the Norma Verticalis. Here you see, this is a superior view of the Norma Verticalis. You see, first of all, its boundaries. So this is the, you see the cursor, the red cursor, this is the anterior boundary. And the anterior boundary, it is formed by the this frontal bone. And posterior boundary is formed by this posterior boundary. See this red laser. This is formed by the occipital bone, this posterior boundary. And the laterally, lateral boundary, on each side is formed by the parietal bones. These are the boundaries. And then the bones taking part in the formation of this Norma Verticalis is a frontal bone and parietal bone on each side, two parietal bones and the occipital bone. So these are the four bones taking part in the formation of the Norma Verticalis. And these are the bones, and then the landmarks. What are they over here? So you see, this is the bregma, and this is the lambda. First of all, you see these 2 points. These were mentioned in detail in the craniometry, right? Craniometry of the skull in my previous lecture. Craniometric landmarks. So bregma is the meeting point for the coronal suture. This is the coronal suture, and then this is the sagittal suture, meeting point of the sagittal suture and the coronal suture. And this is the lambda, which is a meeting point of the lambdoid suture and the sagittal sutures, right? So this is the thing. So these were the boundaries I told you. These are the bones taking part into that, frontal, parietal, and occipital. And these are the two sutures. This is the coronal suture. And there it goes in the going down and anteriorly and forwards, and here is the lambdoid suture going downwards and forwards, and there is the sagittal suture. These are the sutures, and this is the posteriorly lambda, this meeting point of this sagittal and lambdoid suture, and this is bregma, the meeting point of the coronal suture and the sagittal suture. This is the point, and here is very interesting. Yes, here you see first, this is the parietal eminence, not labeled over here. It's a protuberance, parietal eminence or parietal tuber. And on to the lateral side, inside of that, there are two foramina on each side of the sagittal suture. These are the parietal foramina for the passage of the parietal emissary veins, right? So that's obviously the former connection of the scalp veins to the superior sagittal sinus, right? This is the, one of the dural venous sinuses. And this point, you see at the laser not labeled, between the two parietal foramina midway at this sagittal suture, this is called as the obelian. So let's see this. These are the boundaries I told you. This is just for written. No point in wasting time again. These are the sutures I told you already. Sometimes, very occasionally, a Vomian suture is also present beyond coronal, sagittal, and lambdoid. Vomian is also present over here, which closes at 2 to 7 years. So I told you the Bragma lambda. So Bragma is the point of the anterior fontanel and lambda is the point of the posterior fontanel. This is also basically a detailed revision. I told you these fontanels already in my previous lectures, the introduction to the bone of the skull. And this is the anterior fontanel where this, what is the fontanel definition? Again, listen, I tell you, this is a membranous structure fontanel which covers the brain. It's not ossified. It's certain specific functions. And this is the posterior fontanel. Two are found on the superior aspect and two are found on the lateral aspect. We'll again discuss on the norma lateralis. So this is the anterior fontanel, right? So it is formed by where is the these coronal suture and the sagittal sutures meet anterior aspect, right? So this is a big large anterior fontanel, and this is the posterior fontanel where the lambdoid suture and the sagittal sutures meet. This is posteriorly, right? And the anterior fontanel, first of all, you know, it fuses or ossifies at 18 months of age. And the posterior fontanel fuses at the 3 months of age, right? So determination of age to some approximation is a function of the fontanel. Then that's the main function is fontanels during delivery, when the vaginal delivery, SVD, spontaneous vaginal delivery takes place. And these fontanel help to mold the skull over each other. And this thus make the presenting head of the fetus through the vagina, so narrow opening, and it can easily pass through that. Otherwise, it's not possible for that big head to pass through that orifice, the vaginal orifice. So this is the function of first function of the fontanel. And the second function is the, it tells about the cerebrospinal fluid pressure, CSF pressure. If the pressure is raised, intracranial pressure is raised, this fontanel would be bulging. And if the pressure is decreased due to some disease, this pressure would be, the fontanel would be depressed. And if there is dehydration, severe dehydration in the fetus, 18 months below, and that would be child or fetus. This could be the, you know, this anterior fontanel would be depressed in cases of dehydration when there is vomiting and diarrhea, the both, vomiting and diarrhea, gastroenteritis. So this is another function of this fontanel. Similarly, of this, with this posterior fontanel, these are the various functions of the fontanel. And as you should know clinically, very, very important. And here we go on, and I told you already these things as well. This is the table again. I pasted over here from, I made it myself, this table for you people. And at this norma verticalis, this is the Bragma, right? I told you already, point of calvaria where coronal and sagittal sutures meet. This is Bragma, I told you. And the vertex, superior point, come to the picture, vertex here. In the anatomical position of the skull, that is the Frankfurt's plane, the orbitomedial plane. This is the middle of the highest point in the middle of the skull, the calvaria, right? This is the vertex. And also in this view is the lambda. I already told you what is the lambda. Lambda. This is again the picture pasted over here. This is the lambda, you know, from this lateral view. This is the Bragma. The meeting of the sutures over the Bragma and the lambda, and this is the vertex, the highest point of the skull in the middle of the point of the cranium in the anatomical position of the skull. So this was a few words about the norma verticalis and now the Norma occipitalis. So let's go through that. Norma occipitalis is the posterior view. So a large portion of that, it is formed by parietal bones on each sides, And this is the occipital bone, which part? The squamous part of the occipital bone, right? So these two bones, and this is the third bone, the mastoid part of the mastoid bone, the mastoid process of the temporal bone, right? You see, these are the mastoid bone, which contain the mastoid antrum, mastoid air cells, and these are the main three bones taking part into the formation of the Norma occipitalis over here from this, right? You have to exclude this mandible and this. Of course, this will be studying there when we remove that arbitrarily, right? So this is the point in the bones taking formation. And similarly, the boundaries, right? So anteriorly, there is a parietal bone here. This is the Norma occipitalis, this, and this is anterior boundary is the parietal bones. And the lateral boundary is again the parietal and the mastoid bone. Then posteriorly is the occipital bone and the component bone that I told you already. Parietal, occipital, mastoid, and occasionally also here a Vomian bone can be present. Vomian bone. So sutures, what are the sutures present in that, and what is lambda? Again, you see lambda, you just learned from a discussion on the Norma verticalis. This is the lambda. Again, I revise, this is the meeting point of the sagittal and the lambdoid suture. This is lambda. So then you go to the, you know, other important points, the total sutures present over here. What are the sutures? Should you look at that, the backside of the sagittal suture, you can say not included in that. Not. This is the suture, is the this one, lambdoid suture, right? And these two sutures, look at that. This is the mastoid process and this is the occipital bone. So this is the occipitomastoid suture. Occipitomastoid suture, labeled over here, occipitomastoid, this. Occipitomastoid suture. This is the occipitomastoid suture, right? So, and the other suture is the, parietomastoid, right? So this is the occipitomastoid and this is the parietomastoid. This is the parietal bone. So this is the parietomastoid. And this is the occipital bone with the mastoid bone. This is the occipitomastoid, right? These are the sutures. Then what is very, very important over here, this is the external occipital protuberance. External occipital protuberance, a very prominent point about 6 centimeters below this lambda. You see this. This is the junction of the head and neck, right, posteriorly. So this is, and a very most important point, most prominent point on this external occipital protuberance is the inion, right? Inion. This is the inion, which you already had learned from the discussion on the craniometric studies, or craniometric landmark study. This is the inion, already told you in my previous lecture. So this is the inion. So this is the, then the lines are three lines, sometimes two lines. This is the superior knuckle line, constant feature, and the inferior knuckle line, right? And sometimes there is the highest knuckle line, not shown on the label over here, highest knuckle line. I have another picture just coming back to that in the attachments. So this is the thing. So this is, you know, and here is the highest knuckle line. And these are the line. And in the last word here, this is the, you know, crest. This is the external occipital crest. From the external occipital protuberance, the crest is running down towards the foramen magnum, which is an opening into the foramen magnum, is an opening in the base of the skull in the occipital bone. I showed you in the previous lecture, and again I show you going very soon, showing you very soon in the next slides. So this is a external occipital crest going from the external occipital protuberance to the foramen magnum. I told you already, this is the mastoid process, right? And Then again, coming back main to this picture, you see this. These are pointed things. These are the, this is a styloid process visible also here. You have, I have to mention that, that in some pictures, this is labeled, not in my picture here. This is the styloid process of the temporal bone, which will in detail will study Norma lateral study, right? So it is the styloid process, and the structures attached to the styloid process are also called as the styloid apparatus. That we'll learn with the phoenix anatomy. So this is the thing, and moving on. And then the in the last, there are the muscle and the ligament attachments on the Norma occipitalis. And you see this beautiful picture. This is, you know, the external occipital protuberance. And here you see, this is the highest knuckle line. And this is the superior knuckle line, you could see. And below is the inferior knuckle line. This is here. These are the knuckle lines, more beautiful shown over here. This is the occipital part. It's in this part, with from this to this is included in the study of the Norma occipitalis. And this part onwards, obviously, is the study in the Norma basalis, right? So you focus coming back into Norma occipitalis. This is the you know, superior knuckle line, right? And in the medial, one third of the superior knuckle line is attached to the trapezius. And in the lateral half is attached the sternocleidomastoid to the superior knuckle line. Lateral half sternocleidomastoid, and a lateral one third is the attachment of the splenius capitis. Splenius capitis. So three muscles are attached over here. Right, so again I repeat, this is trapezius, and this is sternocleidomastoid, you could see labeled, and this one, you see the red laser, this is the splenius capitis, right? These are the three things, and above to that is the, you know, highest knuckle line, and to that is attached the two structures, which is, you know, gallia aponeurotica, and the occipital belly of the occipitofrontalis, also known as the occipitalis. Here you could see what I'm telling you about that. This is, you know, is a scalp. You come to the lecture very soon. It's already in my YouTube channel. And this even the muscle is the occipitofrontalis. One is the occipital belly, and the other is the frontal belly. Not frontal belly is not concerned over here. I don't really consider in the norm of frontalis. And this is the occipital belly, and of the occipitofrontalis, it is attached to this highest knuckle line, and is along with the you know, gallia aponeurotica. And if not present, this highest knuckle line, I told you occasionally it is present and sometimes it's not, then these two things are occipital belly is attached to the superior knuckle line, right? And this external occipital protuberance also gives attachment to the ligamentum nuchae, right? This is the thing. So this completes the attachments. And then another, in the last one, clinical condition, caput succitanium. So what is that? So you could see this when there is a birth, vaginal delivery of our fetus, and there is some pressure on the head, more pressure, forcefully the head is pushed, pressure, desperate pressure produces a swelling, which is called as a caput succitanium, caput succitanium. So most of the time, it's not anything dangerous, just a normal process, and within few days, it settles down itself. So not to be bothered. So this is the thing. So I thank you very much, and I ask you for support of my channel. Keep, please like my video and comment down below, and please subscribe my channel to help me keep encouraged to make more good videos for you people to enjoy at home and in the times of the COVID-19 third wave. So God bless you. Thank you very much. Bye.